Hey, everybody. So a brief preface to this episode. We wanted to do a comparative analysis between the two productions of The Boys in the Band, both the original 1970s film version and the 2020 version on Netflix. Unfortunately, Netflix has pretty much a strong, strict policy about using any of their material in even a review process. So what we've done is that we've talked about it. There is a small clip that plays from the celluloid closet that we've included that shows Mart Crowley's position on why he wrote The Boys in the Band in the first place. And there are sequences that highlight that, that we think does a fair enough job for it. So unfortunately, we can't do a visual side-by-side comparison, but we do recommend that you take them both in at your leisure, obviously bearing in mind the points we're going to make in this review. So just wanted to give you those few notes up front that we tried to do a complete comparative review of it, and we weren't able to because of Netflix strict policy, okay? So enjoy the review, and we'll see you again. Bye. Hey, everybody, welcome back to the show. So this week we have a very, very kind of odd review in that it is a comparative of the same project, the same screenplay, but with two separate casts separated by nearly 50 years, 40 some odd years apart. So go ahead.
Picture it. 1968, Upper East Side. It's an era when committing a gay act is illegal, and in many places, just being gay is illegal.
Right.
We're talking about Boys in the Band.
Yeah, Boys in the Band. And it's an interesting snapshot of time. You know, my husband was had a boyfriend at that time, and there are stories he's told me about what it was like and what his experience was. He hated the movie. he really,
right there with
it,
him.
When it first came out, he really, really loathed it. And I think most of that was primarily because it is a very, very harsh, introspective look at what society did to queer people and how queer people internalized it. And it was not a happy time. The only thing you can say positively, completely positively, is that it was the first film where gay people didn't die.
Right.
Up until that point, nearly every single film that had portrayed us, we were always the tragic end. There was no happy ending for us.
So the premise, folks, is really simple. Six friends gather for a birthday party in an apartment. And as the evening progresses, they
get drunker.
Get drunker and meaner to the point of shredding friendships and dignity.
Yep.
That's
which is a social commentary of the time.
It is the commentary of the time. And there are a couple interesting characters. The host's college roommate, who is a straight man with a problem that is never clarified, shows up, and he's very Muffy and Buffy went to the club. And so
waspy.
And so he has to deal with being surrounded by gay men who are living it up.
Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah.
But Baz is right. It is the first film where the gay characters did not have to die tragically.
And I would say, I would even say though, it does have an odd other factor to it. I think as an actor, these characters are so dark that it gives you a lot of meat to grapple with because they are so desperately trying to preserve their own flaws in front of others while attacking other people's flaws. And I think that from an actor standpoint, they are meaty roles. There's not a thin one amongst them. They all have, even the naive cowboy stripper kind of guy, you can see he's like looking, and his is mostly, I think, done in an unspoken form, because his eyes just, over the course of the evening, you can see how much their interaction, the rest of their interactions begin to seep into him. And in the beginning, he's very wide-eyed, very, very happy to be there. You know, he's got people he can kind of socialize with and let his hair down. And I think that he's kind of the barometer of the unassuming gay who has no idea what he's in for. As a framework, I'm just saying, from a acting standpoint, from a production standpoint, from a writing standpoint, it's really well written. I mean, you cannot debate that. But I think that it is a very difficult movie to watch. You have to be in a very specific set of mind to do it, you know. But anyways, why don't you give me your rundown of what you thought of the original with actors from that era, obviously, and how they portrayed it. And not all of the cast in that one were gay in real life.
Right.
So it has a different timbre to when you move to the modern reiteration by Ryan Murphy and crew, where it was completely queer cast. So I find that fascinating too. Just from a production standpoint, I find it really fascinating. But anyways, why don't you tell me what you thought and where you go with it?
I don't know that I can put into words that kind of comparison. I had to do a little bit of research after I watched the original film, because I got done and was in a very dark place and wanted to know why I had just wasted that time. So I, and again, beautifully written, historically important, but the level of meanness and the level of meanness that's masked as comedy hurt. It was physically hard to watch.
Yes, it is.
And that was part, and in my research, I learned that part of the success and part of the reason it flew back when it was first out, and it started as a play and then a film, was because it was billed as a dark comedy. And I understand the lines are witty and well written, and I understand they would be zingers. Ow! But they were really written to hurt, and the characters were unleashing their frustration of the world upon each other in a skin flaying manner.
Right. There were take no prisoners.
It was not a friendship circle I could ever allow myself to be part of.
Right. And I think it's interesting, and I totally agree with you. I do. I think my perspective on it is that I first came to know about it because of Celluloid Closet, which is a brilliant documentary, and at some point we're going to cover it in the show. It is a brilliant, brilliant documentary. And one of the things it does so well is that if the writers were around at the time that they filmed it, they included them and their take. So we're going to show you a real quick clip of Martin Crowley's reasoning for writing it the way he did. And it puts an interesting light on where his mindset was at the time. The internalized homophobia that he had taken in and allowed to control his creative process. And I think this was, I don't know, in a weird way, from when every time I watched that clip in Celluloid Closet, I think it was a way of him regurgitating it to get rid of it. He needed to get it all out there and say, okay, one and done. It's out there. I'm not doing that ever again. You know, and I think that really is one of the pros in its favor, is that, yeah, it was a cathartic move on his part, but we were all part of his therapy session, because he does explain that it was slices of his own persona at the time. So from a mental health standpoint, it really does bring to light how bad queers were feeling in that era and what occurred. So we're going to play that clip real quick, and then we'll jump back into the conversation.
Get your troubles, come on, get happy. You better chase all your cares away.
What's more boring than a queen doing a Judy Garland imitation?
A queen doing a Betty Davis imitation.
I knew a lot of people like those people. And I would say that probably all nine of them are split off pieces of myself.
What I am, Michael, is a 32-year-old, ugly, pockmarked Jew fairy. And if it takes me a while to pull myself together, and if I smoke a little grass before I get up the nerve to show my face to the world, it's nobody's goddamn business but my own. And how are you this evening?
They were miserable and bitchy. If I was wrong, it was definitely a reflection of what was wrong in my head. But that's the way that I saw things then.
You're a sad and pathetic man. You're a homosexual and you don't want to be. But there's nothing you can do to change it. Not all your prayers to your God. Not all the analysis you can buy and all the years you've got left to live. You may very well one day be able to know a heterosexual life, if you want it desperately enough. If you pursue it with the fervor with which you annihilate. But you'll always be homosexual as well. Always, Michael. Always. Until the day you die. Friends. Thanks for the nifty party.
I think that the self-deprecating humor was born out of a low self-esteem, if you will, from a sense of what the times told you about yourself. Homosexuality was still classified as a mental illness. You went to a gay bar, you know, you were liable to be arrested or the place be raided. I've been in those situations. There were still not just attitudes, there were laws against one's being, the core of one's being.
If we could just not hate ourselves so much. That's it, you know. If we could just learn not to hate ourselves quite so very much.
And so now you see kind of where Martin's head was. And in a way, it's really interesting. I'm going to share a small story about my husband. At the time, he was with his boyfriend and in the late 60s, and they had gone to see the movie. Now, mind you, because queerdom was outing yourself or being outed was the worst thing that could possibly happen back then. It was literally the worst thing that could happen. Your career would be destroyed. Your family would be ashamed. You know, it wasn't just you. It was everyone you knew got hauled out onto the carpet when it happened. So that's how desperate it was. So my husband and his boyfriend didn't really have an open relationship in that manner. In fact, my husband tells a story that he and his boyfriend one time decided to go to a gay bar in that era in Ohio. And he said he was so traumatized from the experience because he had never witnessed gay men around each other in that way. And even the windows, he said the windows were blackened out in the club. And so everything was dark. It was ominous. It had this air of, you know, it spooked him to be quite honest. They never went back. They never went back to that bar. They never, you know, it was easier to live your life privately than to try and socialize with others. So I think the kids nowadays, I think in a way it is a grand history lesson for them, that of, and it is exemplary of why our, my generation, the generation before me, my husband's generation, why they fought so hard for what we enjoy now. And I think that queer kids should watch it because it gives them a snapshot of how tough it was at that time. It is a history lesson in as much as it is a therapy session, you know, kind of thing, you know? So that's my takeaway from it. I loved the performances. I loved, you know, the only thing I'm disappointed about is that Ryan Murphy's produced version, he didn't direct it, but his produced version is literally almost a shot for shot remake. And I would have liked to have seen something else to bring it, give it a new flavor. You know, I understand, I've never really liked shot for shot movies when they do a remake. They did it with Psycho and I just was really, you know? And so I kind of wish they had done something different with it that may have tied, been a bridge to that period in history to modern queer audiences.
They start, well, that's just it. The modern one started, they almost did exactly what you're asking for in that they, there's a scene where the characters start talking about their histories, about who their first love. And in the modern one, they actually filmed and shot younger versions of the character speaking, like just shadowy reflections of that, but it was filmed and shot and included in the film that wasn't in the original. And that was a start. I think if they had pursued more of that, shown more of that, shown more of that history and how it affected them back then and why they chose to never tell their true love, why it was true love, I think that would have filled in the gaps.
The main couple who host the party, you can see they do have
they're not a couple.
Well,
Harold is just visiting. He stays there on the weekend.
Yeah. I know. But I mean, they have a past.
Well, they all have a past.
Well, yeah. But I mean, they have a past together. I mean, there is something that's there.
Harold has a past with everybody in that room.
Well, that's true. Yeah, that's true. But I mean, theirs is probably the closest to being the most loving relationship.
I'll grant you that.
And so I think the idea that you have it does cover the spectrum. When you get to the part where the guest of honor arrives and Zachary Quinto, I think it's interesting some of the choices some of the modern actors made. It does put a different spin on the characters. And so from that aspect, I really did like what they did. But that made it slightly different, but I like you, I wish they had done some other things to maybe bridge it to a more, I don't want to say more modern time, but they could have done it in such a way that would have made it more palpable.
Right. Right.
In that respect. Do you know what I mean?
I do.
So, I kind of, at this point, I'm kind of wanting to lean, and okay, let's do this a slightly different way. If you're comparing the first version with actors from that era who were living the reality, some of them, because not all of them were gay, and you compare it to the modern with actors who live a much more open life, the stigma is gone. And they're having to translate their experiences into this. Which of the two productions did you like better? Which one did you find? Were they equal? Were they?
No. Believe it or not, if I ever have to watch this story again, I would watch the original. I love my modern actors. I love those guys individually and together so much.
Yeah, but I would love to see them do something else together.
Me too. Absolutely.
Because there is a solid chemistry with that group.
Yep. But this story, I'd go back to the original cast.
You know, remember, kind
of knowing that not all of them were gay.
You know, it's really interesting. It'd be kind of funny to see them do a remake of The Women, which was really kind of gay quippishness and culture, and have them do a real comedy that's biting. And I think this is probably the thing that probably irks me the most about The Boys in the Band, is that when you look at The Women, which is an iconic queer film, a lot of gay men really love The Women, because it is a discussion about women who are married to their men or have men in their lives, and all they do is talk about their men and their relationships with them. But they do it in a very kiki, very, very gay sort of way. And
okay.
A lot of gay men saw it as that kind of speak. And I've often wondered if we should actually review it from that standpoint on these reviews, because it is a very queer icon. Like Anti-Mame, it is a very queer icon movie. And it's highly acerbic. It's got all the same jabs and zingers, but it's done in a way that takes the sting out of it.
I'd never get you alone. I can't wait to get the lowdown.
You're going to swoon, my dear, when I tell you. You know I go to Sydney's for my hair. Oh, you ought to go, Pet. I despise whoever does yours.
No, it looks awful, but never mind. Hurry up. Well, this manicurist, Olga, is a riot. Isn't that divine jungle red?
Simply divine. Go on.
Well, I was looking through Vogue, the one with Mary in the Bozarts ball costume.
You mean that one in the white wig that flatters so
yes,
much?
Yes, that's the one. That's what started this girl on Mary, and the whole ghastly story rolled out.
Yes, but is it someone we know?
No, that's what's so awful about it. She sells perfume at Black's Fifth Avenue.
Black's? Oh, what?
Oh, it wouldn't be so bad if Stephen had picked somebody from his own class, but a Basil.
Yes, but how did Stephen ever meet a girl like this?
Oh, how do men ever meet girls like that? That's all they live for, the rats.
Oh, you know, somebody ought to shut that manicurist up.
A good piece of scandal like that, not a chance. Give me the soap. Why, that girl never stops talking. You know how those creatures are. Babble, 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 babble. Never let up for a minute. A lot they care whose lives they ruin. 10 cents a cake. Well, of course, it's all right to be homespun in the country, but really.
Isn't it a dirty trick?
Isn't it foul?
Oh, cheap Chinese embroidery. You know, I'll bet Peggy gave her these.
It wouldn't be so bad if only Mary's friends knew. We could keep our mouths shut.
Oh, I know plenty I'd ever breathe about my friend's husband.
Oh, so do I.
But you know, I adore Mary.
I worship her. My dear, we're not only cousins. She's my very dearest friend in all the world. After all, we were raised together. Oh, Edith, I forgot to tell you.
Bring it up, girl. Bring it up.
Darling, you're so slim, I could kill you.
You know, half the diet I'm on is pure poison.
How can you exercise all day and look so contented, dear?
Oh, just a trick I learned from the cows. So sorry to be late, girls.
It's all right, Mary. We haven't had a dull moment. Well, Sylvia, feeling better?
Meaning what?
You and Edith look so relaxed. It must have been choice.
It was.
What are you talking about?
Nothing. Oh, how's Stevie?
Oh, not so well lately.
Oh? What's the trouble?
Just the nerves, I guess. Belt has had nerves in his for years. You should hear that man rumble like a truck on cobblestone.
Nice finish, sir, Mrs. Hayes.
Thanks,
Jim.
Oh, there's nothing worrying Stevie, is there?
Oh, no, I don't think so. He's been working too late the last few weeks, that's all.
Are you sure it's work, darling, and not a beautiful blonde?
Come on, Sylvia, let's feed. I'm fed.
Do you see what I'm saying?
I think what you're saying.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that if Martin had taken that approach, then I think this could have been a classic that anyone could enjoy in any period of time. But it's because it went so dark.
Yeah.
You know, trigger warning, if you have mental health issues, that
self-esteem issues,
this is not the movie for you. It does go dark. And it's unfortunate. I understand Martin Crowley's perspective on it, but if anything, it is a litmus test for what gays went through in the before time.
Back when the dinosaurs roamed the earth.
Yeah. Where black and white was the only option for TV. You know, and I think that's its only redeeming value at this point, is that it is well written, it is well produced, it is well acted, they're all meaty roles, but it is a tough watch. I put it on the level of like Schindler's List tough watch. I enjoyed that movie, but it was dark AF too. And I struggled with frames of that movie. This is like that. It is dark. The humor is bitchy Queens.
Yeah.
But on a steroid level that even RuPaul's Drag Race doesn't get to.
Right.
You know?
There's another reason to watch it too. If you are of my age and say, I don't know, when you freshly get out of college and you first start meeting people that first summer after graduation and they're older and they are tearing each other up and making comments about you and being too pretty to get it, they're actually probably quoting from this movie. And you may not figure that out until the year 2020.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no. So that actually happened to me. Summer after college, I started meeting older professionals in Madison.
You were the Texas cowboy.
I was the pretty boy at the party. Yeah. And while I'd like to think I'm slightly smarter than the cowboy in the movie, I didn't know what they were referencing because I had never seen the film. So all of the barbs were flying and the nasty comments about me were flying and I didn't understand why.
Mm-hmm.
And I walked away from those people and hadn't even thought about that particular night until I watched this movie. And then I understood why they behaved the way they did, why they thought they were cool.
Yes. And you know, it's interesting. I just suddenly thought of this. In the Tales of the City with Armstead and Maupin, you have both in the modern version, the one they just shot, and in the older version back in the 90s, you have sequences with gay men, white gay men gathering around a table. And shooting the shit, having their dark little kiki. And that is a boys in the band moment in that work. So Armstead, being from that era, same, you know, era that Martin Crowley was from, it's rather interesting to see that its influence influenced others who were queer content creators, that it almost seems requisite. You know what I mean?
Yep.
That's something I hadn't thought about before until just right now when you were talking about that. I'm like, wow, that's why gays, I mean, because when they did the one in the modern tale where it really took on the let's be kinder to each other, let's respect each other, let's, where that got hammered by the older gay generation who were still carrying that baggage of oppression and the, well, fuck you because I lived through this and so my pain is worth more than your, you know, wanting to placate everyone and respect everyone. Nobody respected me and, you know, old men shaking their cane on the lawn, you know. I mean, that's really what it boils down to, you know. And I think that that's a really interesting take, how that one production affected other queer men content creators of that era. I mean, you look at Larry King's Faggot, the book. You look at, you know, there was that whole, even though it's a lot of the Violet Quill, which is why we use quills, by the way, in this, the Violet Quill gang of the 80s and 90s wrote a lot of dark material because of what was going on with the AIDS thing. But I think that that was also emblematic of Martin Crowley's dissertation, if you will, of queer life in 1968. And it's kind of stuck with us.
Well, it has the power of being the first. Yeah. And that's powerful.
Yeah. Yeah. Everything is measured against that. But it, like I said, it, I think it's interesting. If you go back to the women of 1939, there were three major films. This is your little film history moment. There were three major films produced in 1939, Gone with the Wind, Wizard of Oz, and The Women. And they're all tied together, not only because of the year they were produced, but because they all involve the same directors. Wizard of Oz had a change of directors. Gone with the Wind went through a change of directors. The Women went through a change of directors. And they all rotated between these films. Some of the directors never got credit for the work they did in any given one of those three films. And it's interesting because the women is the one that the queer community attached itself to. So even if we say you go to the first, that's really where gay men honed in, because I remember old queens that I met. Remember that story I told you, or I told in my afterlife series with Tuffy about being in a leather bar with a bunch of older gay men? Mm-hmm. The women came up, you know, and that was the first I had ever heard of it. I didn't even know about it at that point in the 80s when all that went down. And so I became intrigued. I wanted to know about it. And really, yeah, if you look at, I think the women is now the ideal of being smart and quippy and, you know, talking about their men's kind of thing, the kiki, as we like to refer to it. But it's not, there is still some level of communal love between them all. They care for each other, even though they may throw a barb or two at each other every now and then. In a way, it's kind of a loving slap to keep them in line, each other in line, so nobody gets a big head, you know. Mm-hmm. But then you get to the 68 era when Boys in the Band comes out, and it never attains that level of, I am only saying this because I care.
Right.
You know, and I think that's what's missing in this whole thing. There is no thread of love.
Right. And specifically, they are saying this because they're hurt.
Yeah.
And they're hurting.
Yeah. And so it's easier to hurt someone else so you don't have to look at your own pain.
Yep.
You know? So yeah. I'm going to give it 3 quills. And the only reason I'm doing 3 is because of the production value, the importance of the film. It's actually more like 2.5, but I think that I'm giving it the extra half only because I think it is an important snapshot in time. It's not a pretty one by any stretch of the imagination. It is not. Mm-hmm. The 60s were a huge era of turmoil all the way around. I mean, you could mm-hmm. take this same premise and do it with the hippie counterculture.
Yep.
You know, you could, there were so many factions of society at that time that it's hard to imagine for a modern art audience how fractionalized and how siloed the greater society was at that time. Queers were getting more and more notice. Mm-hmm. They were the subject of 60-minute, you know, episodes. Mike Wallace famously had, you know, a documentary about the psychosis and psychoanalysis of homosexuals that was very famous at the time, mm-hmm. with a doctor who was later, you know, repudiated for his perceptions and his take on homosexuality. And so you have that going on. You have the hippie counterculture. You have the violent protests against the Vietnam War. You have the edification of traditionalists who wore the horn-rimmed glasses and had the pocket protectors and wore the business suits with the hats and all that stuff. All of that congealed at that time, and it led to when queers finally broke out in 69, the year later, mm-hmm. and said, we will no longer be in the closet. You know, and I think this is that penultimate moment in time when you can see the volcano of Stonewall coming. It's definitely, this is the anger that gave way to that.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Yep. So for me, it's 3 quills, mostly for historical reasons. And the fact that I do like that this project, while it's dark and hard to watch, it is wonderful to see gay men telling our own stories and allowing us to bring the subtle authenticity of a life lived because you understand it. You have a commonality. I think the downside for between it and like the women is that, like I said, the women had a thread of love. They did these things because they cared about each other. Whereas mm-hmm. in this one, they were so involved with their own self-hate and loathing and anger at what society was doing to them that they're just lashing out to protect themselves. And it's that's what makes it the hard watch. That's the part that you don't get any moment to breathe of love between each other. And in fact, when you get to Michael and Donald's sequence at the end where he says, if we just learn not to hate ourselves so very, very much. And I think we did to a great degree, but man, was it a slog to get there. So that's my take. Three quills. What's your final summation?
One. Mm-hmm. And it has earned the one for its place in history and for the story it told. It lost out on a second because it was so hard to watch. It lost out on a third because I know a bit more about my state's history. And Wisconsin actually has a pretty known history of loving same-sex relationships. I mean, as early as World War I, World War II, well, and I'll give an example. Pendarvis is a historic estate started in Wisconsin by two men who lived together most of their lives. And that story could have been told as well, and it wasn't. So I think I would have liked to have seen something that gave me hope that there was healing or mm-hmm. something to bring the darkness up a little bit, and it just wasn't there.
Right. So, no. I fully agree with you. I wish that... Go ahead.
Absolutely watch it for its historic value on the front that it's presented, but know that it's hard. So yeah,
yes. One quill. Yeah. And I fully support your position on it. Like I said, that final sequence is when he says, if we'd only learn to love ourselves, not hate ourselves quite so very much.
Right.
I wish that element and that direction could have been played up during the course of the evening, where mm-hmm. they began to realize mm-hmm. that if we stop hurting each other, we're all we've got. We're the
right.
chosen family.
Right.
And
I think the modern cast missed that opportunity.
Yeah, I do too. That was my take, is that I think it could have been rewritten slightly in the end to bring that little level of hope.
Right. Or even just acted so that the barbs weren't designed to kill.
Right.
But maybe they were hey, I love you, but you're doing this thing.
Right. No. Exactly. I mean, you and I keep each other in check while we do all the projects that we're working on and stuff, but it's because we care about each other. We want to make sure that we're supported, that we're going, hey, did you think about, you know, kind of thing.
Did you really mean Harold? No.
Yeah, right. Yeah. But it's like, I think that there is, you know, it's just tough because at that era, they probably really, really had no hope in right. many respects. And like I said, it's the penultimate moment. It's before the volcano of Stonewall. And yep. if you watch this movie, you will then understand the rage and anger that Stonewall had, mm-hmm. Because this is where queer people were before that. So it is a must see at some point. But again, if you have self-esteem issues, watch it with someone. Make sure you're in a confident frame of mind that you can internalize it.
Don't be afraid to ask for a hug afterward.
Right. And you know, watch it in bursts if you can't watch the whole thing. Because I think what it does is it will give you an appreciation, a new understanding of why Stonewall was so damn important and why Compton's in San Francisco 5 years earlier was so damn important. Mm-hmm. Because queer people had just had enough. We were tired, so very tired of hurting as much as we were. And we weren't going to take it anymore. We were done. It was over. You know, you're not going to do this to us anymore. And now we're in an era where, you know, with the current judicial climate, we could be right back there. So, you know, vote. Vote.
So what do we got up next?
Next week. It's going to be one that we have been looking forward to. We've touched on it many times with our guest. We actually have a guest of honor next week. It's Brent Hardinger and his work, The Geography Club. And Brent is an amazing, amazing storyteller and great conversationalist. Can't wait for that one. Hopefully we'll get a photo bomb of his husband sneaking in. I'd love to see Michael.
That would be awesome.
And you know, it's just, it's going to be a lot of fun. So we highly recommend you see that one. It is a completely different, it's a drama, but it's done in a way that I think is hopeful and encouraging. Mm-hmm. So, you know, definitely watch us, you know, look for us next week when we release that episode.
Yes.
Until then, this is Baz.
Vance.
Yep. And we're saying, you know, keep watching those movies and we'll keep talking about them here on The Rote Reviews. Have a great night. Bye-bye.